You are listening to The Cajas show on Kofi FM 97.2, and our guest for page three this week was born in LA but is a diehard New Yorker who was drawn to the city by the music, art, and its energy. Michael Mayo is a singer, songwriter, arranger who studied at the New England Conservatory of Music, including the Hancock Institute of Jazz, and was mentored by the man himself, Herbie Hancock. And he released his debut project, Bones, in 2021. And now we get to catch up with him ahead of his next project, which comes out October 4th, that he has titled Fly. Kofi FM, please help me welcome Michael Mayo.
Hello. Thank you so much for having me.
Welcome to South Africa, Mayo. Welcome. You know, thank you for joining us, by the way. Let's go back, you know, to LA for a moment and reflect maybe on your upbringing and why you fell in love with the music.
Yeah, so I grew up in a very musical family. Both of my parents are musicians. My mom is a singer. My dad is a saxophone player who he also is a great singer. And so for me, that of a professional musician was the first career that I knew that someone could have. So I was really blessed to grow up in that environment. And, you know, when I would go with them to their shows and rehearsals and on tour from time to time, when I would watch them from the wings from backstage, I always knew really early on that that's what I wanted to do. There was never any real doubt in my mind. You know, of course, at that age, you don't know what the career will look like, but I always knew that I wanted to have a career in music because it always just resonated really strongly with me.
Yeah. And I think maybe to also bring in the listeners a bit more and give a bit of background, you know, about you. Both your parents were in the music industry for as long as you were alive, right? Your mom having worked with everyone from Diana Ross to Whitney Houston, and your father was a saxophonist for Earth, Wind & Fire. Now, what did that household sound like? It must have been an incredible jam session.
Yeah, I mean, like, we communicate in song. My mom will tell me to wash the dishes, like, with, like, an operatic voice, or, like, anytime I call either of my parents, it's very, like, there's just, the singing is absurd and unending. And they're both still working. Like, they both are still working musicians in LA, and they both still tour, they both still play, and yeah, very, very musical to the point of insanity.
I can imagine the chorus that carries on in the house. You know, having lived in LA, you know, born in LA, what was it about the arts, music, and energy that drew you, or maybe even appealed to you, about New York City?
So I had gone to New York a handful of times in my upbringing, but I had only ever been there for a few days at a time. I never really got to feel the city for any length of time. And when I was at the Hancock Institute, the summer between my first and second year, I spent 2 years, or excuse me, 2 months in New York. And it was really my first time actually getting to spend some time there. And there was just, you know, there was just such a spirit and energy that took me, and I felt really inspired to be there. And it's funny because I actually don't know if you got this part, because it's new, but I moved back to LA late last year. And it was kind of similar. You know, I had a really amazing time in New York, and I would never trade that time for the world. And I'm much better off for having lived there. But a couple years ago, I sort of started feeling the itch of, like, what about LA? What about moving back home? And similarly, the energy here really feels right for where I am now.
I mean, Kofi FM, we're spending time with Michael Mayo this Sunday on the K-Jazz show, and he's our musical guest. We're chatting everything from his moving around between New York and LA, the music, and of course, growing up in a musical home. Now, you released the project Bones, which is a more R&B soul offering. And now you're about to release Fly, which is a more jazz vocal, you know, appealing to a new listener, you know, if you may. How would you define yourself as a musician and maybe your genre, Michael?
Yeah, it's a big question. I would say that before I started getting into jazz, you know, Motown, R&B, soul, neo soul, gospel music, funk, all of that was part of my upbringing. My dad grew up listening to jazz, and so like I had jazz unconsciously in my ear, but it wasn't really until I was like 13, 14 when I started going to high school that I started really getting into the music, and it just sort of took over my entire, I was so inspired immediately by it. And so the way that I describe it is jazz is inherent to what I do. It's like, it's an integral part of my musical formation, but it's also not everything. So like without it, I wouldn't have the sorts of expression that I have, but with only it, I also wouldn't have the sort of expression that I have. So it's like everything is sort of tying together from all these different influences. But this album, I really felt like I wanted to pay homage to a lot of my jazz upbringing. And it feels just as me as my last album felt. Mm. It's just like me in a different way than the last album was.
I didn't know what time it was, then I met you. Oh, what a lovely time it was, so sublime it was too. I didn't know what day it was, you held my hand, warm like the month of May it was. And I'll say it was grand, grand to be alive, to be young, to be mad, to be yours alone. Grand to see your face, feel your touch, hear your voice, say I'm all your own. I didn't know what year it was, life was no prize. I wanted love, and there it was, shining out of your eyes. I'm wise, and I know what time it is now. I did not know what year it was, life was no prize. I wanted love, and there it was, shining out of your eyes. Oh, I'm wise, and I know that I'm wise, and I know that I'm wise, and I know what time it is now.
I want to talk about the Bones thing now.
Sure.
You know, the debut is called Bones, and yeah, the upcoming project has a song, A Bag of Bones. Let's talk about that connection.
What's funny is I actually wrote the song Bag of Bones before I even wrote any of the music from Bones. And I wasn't actively thinking, like, I don't have like a thing about Bones, at least not on purpose. The song Bag of Bones came to me when I was asking a lot of questions about life and death and spirit and things like that. And, you know, looking at the body as sort of what we're inhabiting and what comes before, what comes after, if anything. And the album Bones is more a letter to myself in a lot of the different stages of my life when I was writing those songs. So I always say that the album, I called it Bones because each song represents an integral part of who I am. So it's kind of like the bones of my vibe are on that record. And then Bag of Bones is more about just like the journey that a soul takes. So maybe there's a connection, but maybe not. Who knows? I'll let listeners be the judge.
I'm sure they'll figure it out some way. Let's talk about the new project, Fly, you know, and the inspiration this time around. What did you do differently?
So this album has really been an exercise in learning how to let go and learning how to trust my instincts. You know, with the first album, and I have no regrets with that album. I'm really, really happy with that album, and I always will be. But that one was a lot more, a lot of deep consideration for a lot of really small details, and like really focusing on crafting it as more of like an orchestral work. And this one, I really wanted to really just let myself fly, like let myself follow my first mind, and spend less time doubting and nitpicking and trusting in the musicians that I had that they would bring these songs to life. And it felt totally different for me, the process of making this album, and it felt a lot more organic. And it's interesting because, you know, this album is definitely a capital J jazz album, right? And, you know, I think I was a little bit resistant to doing that for my first album because I felt like I had to distinguish myself in some sort of other way. But this album just feels like such a nice moment in time for me to capture. It feels really representative of who I am right now. And it also feels representative of like what Bones was to me and still is to me. And it's like a nice evolution from the first project into the second project, I'd say.
But would you say that this is, are you comfortable now with the capital letter J, jazz, as an artist going forward?
Definitely, yeah. And like, I would say that I was comfortable with it before in terms of like general musical expression. Like if I could have done jazz gigs, in fact, I was doing a lot of jazz gigs then as well. But in terms of like my first statement, my first album, I did sort of want to lead with some of the other stuff. But I also feel like now that I've established that, I feel a really beautiful freedom to be able to go wherever I want to go. And right now, this is where I want to go. And I try to limit myself as little as I can. And again, that's what this album has been about. It's like, why spend time focusing on limiting yourself when you can really just let yourself live and express and fly?
Was a sentimental thing, threw my heart away each spring. Now a spring romance doesn't stand a chance. Promise my first dance to winter. All I've got to show a splinter for my little flame. Spring this year has got me feeling like a horse that never left the pole. I lie in my room, staring up at the ceiling. Spring can really hang you up the most. Morning's kiss wakes trees and flowers, and to them I'd like to drink a toast. I walk through the park just to kill the lonely hours. Spring can really hang you up the most. All afternoon, those birds twitter-twit, said I know the tune, this is love, this is it, and I heard it before, and I know the score, and I've decided that spring is a bore. love stepped in around the new year. Now it's April, love is just a ghost. Spring arrived on time, but what became of you, dear? Spring can really hang you up the most. Spring can really hang you up the
Jazz on 97.2.
and fly you did. And of course, I want to talk about this journey. You know, you didn't start off as a songwriter, but ultimately went on this journey to become one. Let's reflect on this and how you got the confidence then, you know, to start writing.
Yeah. So I would say, like, I've always really enjoyed putting my ideas down, recording myself, writing little melodies, writing little chord progressions and things. I wasn't always comfortable writing lyrics because I had sung a lot of really amazing lyrics and heard a lot of really amazing lyrics and also sung a lot of not so great lyrics and heard a lot of not so great lyrics. And so sometimes as a songwriter,
yeah,
you can judge yourself before you even put pen to paper. And I spent a lot of time doing that. And finally, I realized, similar to what we were just speaking about, I don't actually have to worry about that. Sometimes it's better to just, like, let yourself get the idea down and then look at it,
yeah,
rather than, like, stopping yourself before you've even written anything down.
Wow.
And getting too focused on the little details. And Bones for me was, like, my first time really letting myself trust my songwriter instincts and trust my lyricist instincts.
Yeah.
And yeah, it took a long time for me to really find that confidence. But in my opinion, there's no real better teacher than just trial and error. You sort of learn on the job.
Learn as we go. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm. You feature your parents on a track here on this project, on the title track, Fly. Let's talk about that experience. I mean, you already grew up with opera singing to the dishes, you know. How was that? How was that experience now officially getting into the studio and putting in track? And I know you guys sang also on Bones, right?
Yeah, so this one felt really different than Bones, because Bones we recorded remotely. So I was in New York when we recorded Bones. And granted, I was in New York when we recorded Fly as well, but the part that I had my parents do on Bones, they did in LA while I was still in New York. And it was kind of a frenzy to try to get everybody together to make the idea happen, because they did it while we were mixing the album.
Yeah.
And whereas with Fly, we recorded everything with the band in New York, and then I went back to LA and I said, I know I want to have my parents on something, because I sort of started this tradition now and it always feels really good. So let's go for it. And I realized as we were recording Fly, I'm like, I think it might be this one. In fact, I think it has to be this one. And so I'm like, hey, Mom and Dad, I know we've talked about having you on the album. This is the song I'm thinking of. I'm going to send you the demo. Let's go. Like, find something to do and do that. And I'm like, I'm not going to be too precious or specific about it, because, like, I trust their instincts. I'm just going to send them the song and see what happens. So I sent it to both of them.
Mm.
And my dad was like, so maybe let me double the vocal melody with you on saxophone. I'm like, great. And he's like, I can also record a couple little horn things as well. And then my mom arranged the background vocals. And so basically, after I got back from New York from recording the live takes with the band, I went into my dad's studio with me, my mom, and my dad, and we listened to my mom's vocal arrangement, which was incredible.
Yeah.
And then we started working on it and, like, adding little things. It was all very organic, and we work really well together, and we blend really well together. And it just, like, every time I sing with them, it reminds me, like, why I do what I do. It's such a beautiful, wholesome family
experience. I think a Christmas album is on the way. I don't know. Something's just said.
Heard. Noted.
Oh man, we're spending time with Michael Mayo this Sunday. This is the K-Jazz Show, and he is all the way in LA, and we're chatting about all his work and his work with music, in fact, and just some of the interesting tidbits about him and the music. And of course, you know, you've had some great mentors, Mike, along the way, Herbie Hancock amongst them. I want to ask, you know, for someone who's listening as an upcoming musician, how important is it, you know, to have a mentor as an artist? Yeah.
I think it's really important. I think it's really clarifying to have someone older and experienced just give you advice and give you an ear. And it also is such a good way to find new inspiration, right? I think, like, you know, now in the age of social media, right, it's really easy to see and hear a lot of different things, which is good. But because sometimes there's so many things, it can be hard to know what to focus on, and it can be hard to know what to pay attention to. And having that older, wiser voice sort of guide you in the right direction can be really helpful. And even if you don't end up doing everything that they say, right, it can just be really helpful to clarify what you do want. I think sometimes someone telling you something that you don't want can be as clarifying as someone telling you something that you do want, because it just helps you to sort of really get a sense of what is it that I want to do, what are the steps that I want to take. And yeah, if you have the ability, if you have access to older experienced musicians to ask them questions, I would say definitely go for it, because it can be really helpful. You know, obviously be conscious of people's space and energy and time, right?
Absolutely.
But if they seem open and willing to talk to you about this stuff, like, just be there and listen and ask questions.
Yeah, and equip yourself. You know, I think that's the most important part. Where to for Michael?
Yeah, I mean, I'm already starting to think about album number three. I can't make any like special declarations or anything, but I am very much a musical go-getter. I really like to just follow the music and follow the inspiration.
Yeah,
and I just sort of feel the call for music in a lot of different directions, and sometimes it can be challenging to know what direction I'm going to go, but I always feel like if you're letting the music guide you, you can't ever really go wrong.
Yeah.
And so I'm just really excited for people to hear this project, because it's been I've been working on it for the better part of a year, and I'm really, really proud of it, and I'm very excited for people to finally get their ears on it.
Well, we will be listening. And of course, October 4th, the project comes out, and we'll be listening to some of the tracks. In fact, we've been playing some of the tracks in the hour and listening to music there by Michael Mayo. He's, I think, singer-songwriter, arranger, and music extraordinaire, right? Is that cool?
I'll take it. Sure.
And of course, he spent some time with us here on the K-Jazz Show.
Of the wonderful things that you get in a life, there are four. Now there may not be many, but nobody needs any more. Of the many facts making the list of life, truth takes the lead, and you relax, knowing the gist of life is truth you need. Then the second is honor, and happiness makes number three. When you put them together, you know what the last one must be. Baby, so the truth, honor, and happiness, and one thing more, meaning only wonderful, wonderful love that'll make it four. facts making the list of life, truth takes the lead, and to relax, knowing the gist of life is truth you need. then the second is honor and happiness makes number three. When you put them together, you know what the last one must be. Baby, so the truth, honor and happiness, and one thing more, meaning only wonderful, wonderful love that'll make it four. Make it four.